My name is Dr. Pat Doro, and I am your local dentist. I've been in private practice here in Manhattan for over 20 years, and I've been doing this live call-in show for over 18 years. And you know what? I decided tonight, instead of talking about our dental problems, I thought I'd talk about something more important. How about if we talked about our pets' dental problems? And so that's the topic of tonight's show. We'll be talking about pet dentistry. And I have three guests tonight that I'd like to introduce that is actually going to answer any questions you have about your pet, whether it's a dog or a cat or any other pet, about dentistry. So Bob, if you can put the phone number at 247-8090, if you can put the phone number up, if you have any questions about your pets, please call in. And so at first I'd like to introduce my guests. Okay. My first guest with me has been on the show. He's an old pro. He's been on the show since 1988. And this is Mr. DJ. And Mr. DJ is a Maltese that has been on the show since he was a tiny little puppy. And the reason this has been so important to me is because we have watched this dog go through many dental problems over the years. And now I actually have a specialist that can help explain them. So if the camera can pull back, and I'd like to introduce my next guest. My next guest is Dr. Dan Carmichael, and he is actually not only a veterinarian, but he's also a veterinarian dentist. And on his lap is another little sweetheart that's been on the show for a long time, Mr. DJ's wife, Frosty. So I'd like to start out with Dr. Carmichael. Tell me about this new specialty called veterinary dentistry. Am I pronouncing that right?
Veterinary.
Dentistry.
Dentistry. And veterinary dentists are responsible for taking care of the special dental problems that dogs and cats have. Well, any animals, actually, because as veterinarians, we are the only dentists that pets have. Whereas most veterinarians are fully capable of taking care of the routine problems with their pets.
You mean like pulling teeth out and
pulling teeth and the routine scaling. Veterinary dental specialists are there to perform maybe what would be considered more specialized procedures such as orthodontics, root canals, oral surgery, and so forth.
Okay, so I went to college and then I went to 4 years of dental school, then I went to intern residency. What training do you have to become, you're board certified, right?
I'm board certified veterinary dentist.
And how did you get there?
Well, after 4 years of college and 4 years of veterinary school, I went through a 5-year additional residency program after
five
that.
5 years?
5 years.
Wow, what a specialty. I mean, it's more years than I go to school to become a regular dentist.
Well, those 5 years were spent doing about 40% dental specialty work and 60% general veterinary practice. So I retained my ability to practice general medicine as well as perform the specialty dental work.
And how many specialists are there in the country? I've been trying to get one on the show for years, and I was told there's only five. But
in the world, there's, I believe, 37 right now, board-certified veterinary dentists.
So this really is a brand new specialty.
It's one of the newer specialties in veterinary medicine.
Medicine. And your training was at what university?
I did my veterinary training at Cornell University in New York, and I did my dental residency at a private practice in Northern Virginia with Dr. Chuck Williams and Susie Holler.
Is he a specialist too?
They're both board certified dentists.
Veterinary
dentists.
Okay. What if someone goes to dental school and decides that they can't take the people and they want to go back? Would they qualify as a veterinary dentist if they take the right exams?
Well, if a human dentist also decided they wanted to go to veterinary school and did 4 more years of veterinary school, then they could qualify to take the board exam to become a dental specialist for dogs and cats.
Now, what kind of pets do you learn how to do dentistry on? What kind of animals?
Well, we're responsible for the dental care of all animals.
Right.
Primarily, we focus on dogs and cats because they are the most common pets that are brought to us for dental problems. I've done dental procedures on a cheetah.
Cheetah?
A beaver and an otter.
I'm assuming this is not a private pet, this is at a zoo.
These were at the National Zoo in Washington during my residency. But Horses have their own special dental problems, as do all the exotic animals in the zoo. But primarily, we focus on dogs and cats.
Excuse me one second, someone's calling me. Oh, we have a phone call. Hi, you have a question?
Hi, doctor. Thank you for a very informative show. This really has nothing to do with the topic you're talking about now, but I was just wondering, what is your feeling in response to Colgate's new toothpaste? I mean, is it all that it's cut out to be?
Oh, okay. Thank you for your question. What he's talking about, this might be interesting to you too, mm-hmm. is that Colgate has come up with this wonderful, I think they call it Total toothpaste, that supposedly in the commercials keeps on working even though you're not brushing your teeth anymore. And basically, my feeling on all toothpaste, the only toothpaste I ever recommend is just using a box of baking soda, Arm & Hammer baking soda. Because what bothers me about toothpaste and mouthwashes and mouth rinses is that everything in the mouth is absorbed into the bloodstream, into the body. And some of these chemicals in these new toothpaste and in these new mouthwashes like plaques and Listerine, that's being absorbed into your bloodstream too. We don't have any long-term clinical data about what this is doing to our immune system, to our kidneys, to our internal structures, absorbing all these chemicals.
Sure.
So unless your dentist recommends this particular toothpaste for you, he thinks it would be a benefit for you, I would purchase it. But again, I still am very holistic, and I don't believe in taking any kind of medicines, and toothpaste do have medicines in it, like fluoride, like fillers, like preservatives, and flavorings, and as well as mouthwash has a lot of medicine type of things, or chemicals in it. I don't advocate using such things when I know darn well the best way to clean your mouth is elbow grease. In other words, just brushing. You really don't need toothpaste to get your mouth clean. That was just something for people who need to have something tasty in their mouth when, and it will get them to brush their teeth more. But that's not necessarily a recommendation on my part. So I wouldn't recommend that toothpaste. Plus, my patients tell me it's pretty expensive. And if it's not really doing anything, if it's just the elbow grease that's going to clean your teeth, do you really need such a toothpaste? So I know the manufacturer's going to give me a call after the show and say, what are you doing to us? But just from clinical observations over the last 40 years since I've been working in dentistry, I see that just a toothbrush, and if you want a little baking soda, makes your teeth nice and polished and smooth, would be the best deal to brush your teeth with. Thank you for your question. Okay, on the top, we have another phone call. Hi, you have a question?
Right. Yeah, hi. I just got a mini Doberman, and
this is probably for you.
Okay.
Yeah, and I was wondering if it's a good idea to brush the teeth more than once a week or less. I'm not sure exactly how often I should brush my dog's teeth.
Well,
the reason
you're brushing your pet's teeth is to prevent the accumulation of bacterial plaque on the teeth. And we know that even after professional veterinary cleaning, within a couple of days that plaque's going to start reaccumulating on the teeth. And that plaque is the cause of the number one disease in pets, which is periodontal disease. So really, you're going to be wanting to be brushing those teeth once a day. And,
okay, let's talk about what we can brush the dog's teeth with.
Yes. I liken brushing the teeth, when I describe it to my clients, to scrubbing your floor. And probably the most important part of scrubbing the floor is the scrub brush. And we use for a scrub brush a toothbrush. And just a regular child's toothbrush works just fine. This happens to be a special toothbrush that CET makes for brushing dog's teeth. And the handle is shaped in a way that it would be awkward to brush my own teeth with it. But when I'm brushing somebody else's teeth, like Frosty here, it's at a very nice angle. Now, when we brush a pet's teeth, and I'm going to use this little model here, we don't concern ourselves with brushing the inside of the teeth because the tongue does a good job of taking care of that. And we don't concern ourselves with brushing the tops of the teeth because the tops of the teeth in the dog are sharp and they take care of themselves. So just the outside surfaces of the teeth that are easy to get to by just flipping the dog's lip up are what we're concerned about with brushing the teeth. And I know little DJ loves to have his teeth brushed. He brushes his own teeth.
Yeah, and also this is an expensive brush because it's a specially brush made by CET. You can also get the same larger size brush And this is a denture brush. This is what people clean their dentures
okay.
with. So you have a nice large brush. You have more of a surface area. I like the little bend in it. And this is for little spots in the front that if you see a little stain and everything, you can focus on those little areas. So you can go to your vet and purchase a CET brush, but this is a little bit cheaper. You can see these are more readily available in your drugstores and supermarkets as a denture brush. And I see for bigger, snouty dogs, if you're going to get your toothbrush in there, see how much surface area we have here? We have a huge brush. And so it'll brush more of the tooth area. You can get it done a lot faster, okay, than anything. And I also recommend, if you want your dog to take to your brush, you always start young, right, when they're a puppy.
Absolutely.
By putting your fingers in their mouth. Get them used to having your fingers in their mouth. And if you want your dog to start accepting the brush, do we use toothpaste?
No, we don't use toothpaste.
Okay. Don't use toothpaste because the toothpaste tastes yucky to dogs. Plus the fact that dogs can't rinse and spit, so they're going to eat the toothpaste. So if it tastes yucky to them, they're not going to let you come near them at all after that because they know you're going to come with that brush, it tastes yucky, they don't want to have anything to do with it. The best toothpaste to use is your own spit or saliva. And I tell people, when you take a new brush, don't use this with an old brush, unless, you know, you're that kind of person, you just put it in your mouth, get it, put your saliva on it, and then see how the dog takes to it. The dog will take to it right away and let you, because the dogs like to lick you and they like to kiss you, so he'll let you brush your teeth a little bit more readily by doing that. But Doc, there are toothpaste specifically for doggy problems.
There sure are.
Yeah.
And in that example where I likened brushing the teeth to scrubbing the floor, I think of the toothpaste as the scouring powder. And the toothpaste contain microscopic grits that aid in the removal of plaque from the teeth. And also, the toothpaste can be flavored in such a way that it actually turns the dog on to the brush.
Right, so they'll definitely accept the toothbrush more.
Sure.
And they can eat it and swallow it. We don't have to worry about poisoning it.
Absolutely. This is a toothpaste that happens to be chicken flavored.
Ooh.
So just like we seem to enjoy the taste of wintergreen in our mouth, the dogs seem to enjoy the chicken flavored toothpaste. And the whole goal of it is to find some system of brushing the teeth with a toothbrush, or if the dog's scared of the toothbrush, and some dogs are, there's what they call a little finger brush, which is slipped over the finger and it has little bristles on it. And that can be used to apply the abrasion to remove that plaque from the teeth. Also, it offers a little protection of your finger.
Right, so if the dog's teeth slip a little bit.
If they slip a little bit, you're not going to get hurt.
Okay. And I have to laugh because I know the people who invented that, and they invented it for children and babies. And I've shown it on my show for them. I sent them a couple copies of the tapes where I use it on my puppies. And now they manufacture it specifically for puppies and dogs and everything. So what goes around is comes around. You treat a puppy like you would treat a child or a baby. Okay, we have another phone call? On the bottom? Okay. Hi, you have a question?
Yeah, hi. Can you use regular human toothpaste on the dog?
Thank you for your question. Okay, again, if the dog is uncomfortable when you use something in his mouth, he's not going to let you do it again. So human toothpaste does not taste good to doggies. It tastes yucky. So if you're going to use a toothpaste, you can purchase these toothpastes at your vet that have the chicken flavor.
Right.
And then there's also toothpaste I know made by, I think CET makes them too, for people who have dogs who do have sores in their mouth or after surgery that do have a medicine. And they'll help in healing with your dogs. But don't use your own toothpaste on the dogs. Number one, he won't accept it. Number two, it's poisonous to dogs because he won't be able to spit it. He'll eat it, and you never know. When you're not looking, he might. If he does like the taste of your toothpaste, he might eat the whole tube, and then you can have poison the dog. So keep your toothpaste away from the dogs, okay? Now, what about people who don't want to brush their dog teeth? There's an alternative for them.
Well, brushing the teeth is, of course, the best, but the whole goal of this is to prevent the accumulation of plaque on the teeth.
Right.
Now, in the wild, the wolves would chew on carcasses and use that mechanical abrasion to keep their teeth clean. And there are chew products that we can offer our pets.
Like?
Rawhide chews.
Or how about
these,
green beans?
Green beans and carrots also work real good. Look at DJ there chewing on those green beans. But anything that will apply mechanical abrasion to the teeth is going to help to remove that plaque and tartar from the teeth.
And what's nice about the green beans, too, we got a nice little flossing effect here with the the strands of the beans. Have you ever seen a dog eat a green bean?
I've never seen a dog eat a green bean like that.
Okay. But, this is his flossing and his brushing at the same time. Okay, and then we have little gadgets like this. These are, what is this? This is rawhide?
I think it's compressed rawhide. And for dogs that are get upset stomach from rawhide chews, these seem to be a little general on the stomach. They don't last as long, but another excellent product. It doesn't take the place of brushing the teeth, though. Brushing the teeth is still the most important thing you can do to prevent the number one disease in dogs. But anything else you can do is just going to make your job go better.
Then what about eating too much of that? Because dogs really like to chew on that, and these little tiny sticks like that, they can go through them pretty fast.
Sure.
Does that do something to their stomach? A lot of patients have asked me to ask you that.
That's a good question, and you really have to ask the dog. Most dogs don't have any problems with these, but occasionally a dog can develop an upset stomach from these, or even have some gastrointestinal bleeding, and if that's the case, obviously you want to discontinue the product. I've never had to do surgery on a dog, or I've never had a dog become seriously ill chewing on a rawhide. So
then,
I think the benefits by far outweigh the risks.
Okay, and then what about cow's hooves? That's another question my patients ask me to make sure to ask you.
Well, cow's hooves are another product that dogs love to chew on. The problem I have with them is they're a little too hard. And dogs that I know that chew calf's hooves also have very clean teeth. But occasionally I'll find dogs that chew on those also have broken teeth.
That's
a whole nother problem. So yeah. I don't recommend cow's hooves. I don't recommend those hard soup bones for that same reason. Mm-hmm. Dogs can break their teeth on those. And some of the hard nylon bones. I've also performed many root canals on dogs after having chewed on
those
bones.
Because they broke them.
I say those are too hard for the dog.
Okay. We have another question on the top. Hi, you have a question?
Yeah, do you recommend brushing the dog's teeth with fecal matter or battery acid?
Hi, do you have a question? Whoops, okay. So, next question is, when in the zoos, when they have all these animals, they don't brush the animals' teeth. What happens, how do the zoo animals end up with problems? Is it because of a processed diet that they have, or is it because they do chew on things and break their teeth? Like, what kind of emergencies would you have in the zoo? Now, I have a lot of kids, patients, who ask me to ask you these questions. They want to hear something exciting.
Well, exactly. Zoo animals, or animals in general in the wild, have adapted ways to keep their teeth clean, such as the diets that they naturally eat. And in zoos, in some cases, the animals are not eating their natural diets, and that can lead to dental disease. In fact, I know of a poor seal in the National Zoo who developed such bad periodontal disease, all of his teeth literally rotted out of his mouth, just because he was eating a poor diet for that seal.
Then how do the zookeepers know that these pets are suffering or they have?
Well, in many cases they don't, because these animals are still wild animals and they don't allow their teeth to be brushed every day. In many zoos, what they do is on a regular basis, maybe once a year, they'll anesthetize or sedate the animal, mm-hmm. and then give them a complete physical exam, including their teeth, but also check up their heart and their blood tests and sort of an all-in-one shot.
Okay, we have another phone call. Hi, you have a question?
Yes, please. Do dogs actually get cavities? And,
good question.
And another question I have is, what's the next step? We're talking about cleaning the teeth of animals, but what do we do next if the dog has a certain plaque buildup in their teeth now? What does an owner need to do?
Okay, thank you for your question. Okay, do dogs get cavities?
Excellent question. And the answer is yes, but very, very rarely. Mm-hmm. I think of 5,000 dogs I see, maybe
they have a diet of lollipops.
Maybe four would have cavities, and that probably has a lot to do with their diet.
Yeah.
And it probably has a lot to do with the way their teeth are put together. But it's very rare to find cavities in dogs. Now, cats are another exception. It's not uncommon at all to find cavities in cats. They're not true cavities like people get, but they are. They look like cavities. They're erosions into the enamel of the tooth that are very painful for these cats.
Do you treat them?
And well, unfortunately, we found that filling these cavities in cats is not successful. That the fillings don't work. because of the nature of the cavity and the cats continue to be painful. So the treatment for these cavities in cats is extraction of the teeth as the only way to make them comfortable again.
Yeah, so also we have to remind the people if they have cats, they should be brushing their teeth also.
Absolutely.
Okay, but cats, dogs don't really get cavities unless they do have a weird, strange diet.
It would be very rare for a dog to get a cavity.
Okay.
Now, these cavities in cats are not caused by not brushing the teeth. In fact, we don't know what causes the cavities in cats, but if your veterinarian tells you your cat has a cavity, or the fancy word for these is feline odontoclastic resorptive lesions, don't feel guilty, because it's not your fault. We don't know why the cats get those. That last caller also had a good question about what happens if you're brushing the pet's teeth and brushing the pet's teeth, but a dental problem still develops. And, well, that's exactly what happens in people. We brush our teeth every day, yet still it gets to the point where we have to see the dentist. And that's just the case in pets, too. Mm-hmm. And what will happen is when your pet's in to see the veterinarian for the annual exam, they should also do a thorough oral exam. And if it looks like there are symptoms of more advanced dental disease than simply brushing at home should take care of, they'll probably recommend a dental prophylaxis.
Okay. Now, the other thing is AMC, is Animal Medical Center, is where you work here in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And they do have a pet therapy program I'd like to talk about. And the pet therapy program is sponsored by AMC. And what we do is we take pets like this, and pets like, further pets I'm going to show you in a little while. We go to the nursing homes, we go to the School for the Deaf, the Jewish School for the Blind, and various nursing homes, and we hang out with people, with the pets. So if you have pets that are like this, that are very friendly and exciting and move around, I'd like you to call, Bob, you can put it up, you can call Sue Cohen at AMC, and the number is 838-8100. And please volunteer. They also take donations to help senior citizens afford to have pets. Because as you know as a vet, pets can make you live longer.
Absolutely.
You know, and they give you companionship, they give you something to do, something to look forward to every day. And most senior citizens can't afford to have pets, so AMC does have a program called SAVE, in which they do help senior citizens afford to have pets. They give low cost or free vet care, food and inoculations, et cetera, et cetera. So please call AMC if you have an interest in either program, and I'm glad, they'll be glad to hear from you. Okay, I do have two other pets that I take with me on my pet therapy. This is my little buddy, Sweetie, and she's been on the show before, and I have to teach the vet something here today. What's the difference between a male and a female tortoise? Do you know?
Well, exactly.
You hold the female. Okay, the way to tell the difference between a male and a female tortoise. Uh-oh, did I lose my other guy? He crawled away? He went to another show. Okay, that's Sweetie. And I've had her 5 years. This is Fred. I've had Fred, probably now 25 years. And the vet thinks he's between 50 and 75 years old. And this is the male, and you can always tell the difference, especially if you're looking, is the male always have a curved bottom. The female always has flat bottom. And do you know why?
I think you're going to tell us.
I saw this on Jay Leno the other night. There's a little girl who collects tortoises. And she says, Jay, you can always tell the difference because the female has a flat bottom and the male has a curved bottom. So they can do like this. And Jay Leno blushed when the little girl showed him to do that. But that's the reason of that. And these guys not only go with the pet therapy program with me, because, again, they're very sweet to be with. They're very unusual pets. They don't bite. They don't do anything wrong. But they also entertain the guests when they're fooling around. And the nice thing about them is also I belong to the New York Turtle and Tortoise Society. And if anybody's interested in saving endangered species, you can call or write me after the show, and I'll give you the information of the Turtle and Tortoise Society. Or even if you do have pets like this, there is a society that will tell you how to take care of them and how to make them live as long as these guys have lived. Okay, so I'm going to put them over here. Okay, and I lost my pet here. Okay, the other thing is we talked about cats. Oh, and cat food, too. Cat food is usually soft and gooey. Is that another reason why cats tend to have dental problems?
Well, sure. Again, in nature, the cat chews on its prey, but the mushy cat foods do promote the accumulation of plaque on the cat's teeth, so, right.
So
they suffer from the same periodontal disease, if not treated, that dogs or people would if okay. they didn't brush their teeth.
Okay, we have another phone call. Hi, you have a question?
Yeah, hi, I do. I'm getting a dog in a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. It's being boarded right now in Pennsylvania. And it's about 11-month-old puppy. And my sister was giving her dogs, you mentioned these dried animal bones. The dog had a very bad effect on her dog. Someone suggested for chewing purposes to get the Nyla bone or the Kong, is that what it's called? Do you recommend those? Are they good for a puppy's teeth? Or not a real tiny puppy, 11 months old.
Thank you for your question.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, I am familiar with both of those products, and the Kong toy is a softer rubber chew, and that's an excellent toy for exercising the mouth, cleaning the teeth, and it's safe for the dog. Those Nyla bones are excellent for cleaning the teeth, but I found them to be a little too hard for the dogs to chew on, and I've found some dogs have actually broken their teeth chewing on the Nyla bones, so I don't recommend those.
Okay, thank you for your question. Okay, I found this cartoon just before we went on the show. And if the camera can come in for a close-up on this. Okay, it says, dog dentist. You see the dog. He says, gargle and spit. And the dog says, I like this guy. So this is what the dog sees when he sees this guy sitting next to me over here. So if you have any questions about your pet's dental health, and now you know there are veterinary dentists available, you can call AMC to reach Dr. Carmichael for further questions. We also have a lot of brochures on how to take care of your teeth. That we'll be glad to send that for free after the show if you want to call or write either of us after the show. And let's see, the last thing is if you do believe in pet therapy and you want to volunteer, please again call Animal Medical Center after the show. And Doc, I think we're just about the end of the show. You have any more advice you want to give for people and their pets?
Well, my closing word would be we are the only dentists that these pets have, and it's our job as their stewards to take care of their
right.
teeth.
If your dog or pet cat has their teeth longer, they'll live longer and they'll have much better lives. Okay, so I'll see you in a few weeks. Everybody keep smiling and keep having dogs and cats that smile too. Goodbye, everybody. DJ.